Demolition Dad by Phil Earle. Chapter 1. Working 9 to 5. Jake's dad was a demolisher. There's no other or better word for it. No word that can make Jake prouder. From 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, Jake's dad took buildings from the clouds to the floor, sometimes in the blink of an eye. There was no one smarter, quicker, or better at it than George Biggs. Which was just as well, because there were lots of buildings in the seaside town of Seacross that were, frankly, an eyesore, a carbuncle, a green pus-filled wart on the face of the landscape. Dad had been a builder once. A good one too, apparently. But that was before people had stopped coming to Seacross on their holidays in favour of a week toasting themselves in the Costa del Hot. When the tourists dried up, so did Dad's building work. Jake thought his dad deserved to be rich and famous for what he did. He thought crowds should gather to watch him, cheering as he climbed the crane's ladder, whooping when he took the front of the building clean off with a single glance of his wrecking ball. But no one ever watched George work apart from Jake, peering through the fence, and he couldn't understand why. It wasn't as if there was anything else for the people of Seacross to do. After all, George had destroyed the crumbling old cinema 3 years ago, and the bingo hall, and the art gallery. The leisure centre had collapsed on its own, though that's another story. Yes, Jake was George Biggs's number one fan, the proudest son in the history of demolishers' sons, probably ever. The greatest days were the ones where he was allowed to squeeze into the crane's cab with his dad, wedged between his bulging gut and the controls. On special occasions, like his birthday, he was even allowed to manoeuvre the wrecking ball into action. His dad's pudgy sausage fingers wrapped softly over his. It was moments like this that made Jake want to burst with pride. Only the thought of cleaning the mess off the crane window actually stopped him from doing so. I mean, can you imagine the mess? To everyone else, George might have been fat and balding, with a ponytail as bushy as a Shire horse's mane. But Jake knew something that everyone else didn't. And he had a plan. A secret sort of plan. So secret, even he didn't know how it worked. Not fully. He doesn't find out for a good few chapters yet. But bear with him. It's well worth it when the penny finally drops. You see, it wasn't just buildings that George Biggs demolished. Oh no. At weekends, he knocked other things down. And that's when Jake got really excited. Because once this secret was out, everyone would know how amazing his dad was. He could hear the crowd now jump into their feet, chanting louder and louder as Dad hoisted Jake victoriously onto his shoulders. Demolition Man! Demolition Man! Demolition Man! Demolition Man! Chapter 2. The Weekend Job. Tinny music poured through the speakers and the crowd went bonkers. Well, I say a crowd. That depends on your definition of the word. If a crowd to you means three hairy truckers, two bored businessmen, a gaggle of gummy old women and a pair of teenagers snogging each other's faces off, then yes, this was a crowd. A big one. It certainly was to Jake. He'd been to shows where a lot fewer people turned up, and quite a few when the only person applauding and going mad was him. No, tonight the atmosphere was electric, and as the familiar theme tune rumbled around the sports centre walls, Jake felt the hairs on the back of his neck stand on end, just as they always did, no matter how many times he heard it. The music was familiar because Jake had written it on his laptop, on one of those fancy app thingies, a swirling mixture of rolling drums and thrashing guitars. The perfect way of introducing Dad to his legion of fans. Jake knew that right now, Dad would be hiding behind the curtain. Costume on, biceps oiled and flexed as he leaned into the microphone, waiting for the guitars to screech to their peak. "Ladies and gentlemen!" His voice exploded over the speakers, causing a hysterical hiss from the hearing aids in the audience. Readying himself for the ring is the master of disaster, the eighth wonder of the world, the king of sting, the one, the only, Demolition Man, Georgie B! The microphone howled its approval, and the tatty black curtain bulged to reveal Jake's dad in all his weekend glory, 6'5" and 20 stone of Man Mountain, swinging a rubber wrecking ball around his head and decked out in a tatty black leotard which barely kept his rampaging belly under control. At his feet, an old desk fan blew his ponytail out behind him. Jake whooped his approval, fighting the chorus of boos from the pensioners. There he was, the Demolition Man, the wrestler everyone loved to hate. Well, everyone except his son. George threw his hands in the air. He pointed menacingly at the grannies, threatening to break their Zimmer frames for the disrespect they were showing him. Only when he saw Jake ringside did he let the persona slip, winking slyly before straddling the top rope and removing a slice of cold pizza that had been thrown, splat, between his shoulder blades. Instead of throwing the pizza back into the crowd, the Demolition Man grinned and yelled over the noise. "Pineapple on pizza is a crime. I ordered pepperoni." With a mock grimace, he picked off the offending fruit and flicked it to the ground, before folding the entire slice into his gaping mouth. The crowd lapped it up, and so did Jake. Dad was used to having things thrown at him on his ring walk. It happened a lot to wrestlers as they made their dramatic entrance. Pizza, boiled sweets, beer bottles. Dad had once even had to remove a pair of false teeth from his bum cheek after a particularly aggressive grandma got overexcited. She'd never got an ashes back, though. They were sitting in a shoebox under Jake's bed, along with other souvenirs from Dad's wrestling career. Ticket stubs, flyers, an eyebrow ripped from pretty boy Brian's head. Each object was precious to Jake, more loved than any toy he'd ever owned. One day, he knew there'd be a museum in Dad's honour. There'd be exhibits and plaques, statues made of solid gold. Jake took a deep breath. He was getting carried away. Dad had only been wrestling at weekends for about a year, after all. But as for watching it together, that had been going on for as long as he could remember. He and Dad would snuggle on the settee to watch fights. It was their special time. After Jake's little brother Lewis was tucked up in bed and Mum was relaxing with a book, they'd laugh, boo and shout at the TV. "Did you see that move, Dad?" "I did, son, I did. He won't be able to sit down for a week after that." "Not without a rubber ring, no." Once the programme had finished, they'd play fight, reenacting their favourite moments. By the time Jake was 8, he couldn't help noticing the similarity between the Hulks on the screen and the one next to him on the sofa. In fact, Dad was bigger and tougher than most of them put together. How amazing it would be, Jake thought, if it was his dad up there, strutting his stuff. So amazing. Jake decided that it had to happen, and he started to put a plan into action. "You should be a wrestler, Dad." Dad laughed. "Me? I don't think so, son." "Of course you should. You'd squish everyone they put in front of you." Dad growled mock fiercely before hoisting Jake one-handed above his head and up the stairs to bed. But Jake knew Dad was destined to wrestle, even if Dad didn't. And he took every opportunity to tell him so. He drew pictures of Dad in costume, came up with an alter ego and a finishing move for him. He even found a wrestling organisation advertising for new fighters and printed off dozens of application forms, leaving them in Dad's pockets, under his pillow, even once inside a sandwich. Mmm, tasty. In the end, and after a nasty bout of indigestion, Dad got the message. "But why do you want me to wrestle?" he said. Jake stared at him, incredulous. Why couldn't Dad see what he did? "Are you kidding? You're the strongest person I've ever met. You're already the best demolisher in town. So I know if you body slammed anyone in the world, well, you'd probably be the best at that too. And then I'd be even prouder. The proudest." Well, that was it. When your son thinks that about you, there's only one thing you can say. "Grab your coat then, Jake. If I'm doing this, I need you in my corner." And so the Demolition Man was born, though he came with one simple rule. "All of this stays a secret," Dad said. "Our secret." "Oh?" Jake felt a pang of disappointment. If Dad was a champion wrestler, he wanted everyone to know about it. He thought quickly. "But we can't keep it a secret. What about Mum?" Dad looked thoughtful and a little bit scared. Good point. We'll have to tell her. Not that she's gonna like it. No one else, though. Deal?" "Bummer," thought Jake, before having another brainwave. "What about Lewis?" Okay, Lewis too. "But he'll never keep it quiet. We might as well tell everyone." "No," insisted Dad, his eyes as stern as a headmaster who's caught you nicking his favourite sweets from the tuck shop. "No one except family can know. Not even Mouse and Floss." "Oh, but Dad," Jake said, "I don't understand why it's such a big deal. Jack at school boasts about how good his dad is at football all the time. Why do I have to hide this?" "Because Jack's dad doesn't appear in public dressed in spandex, does he? Nor does he have to cover himself in baby oil before a big match." Dad dropped his voice as if suddenly worried someone over the sea in Holland might hear him. "And besides, Jack's dad is a bit, well, thinner than me, isn't he? That'll be your secret weapon, Dad. Look at the world champion on the telly. The tsunami terror. As soon as he sits on someone, that's it. Game over. The terror doesn't have to spend 5 days a week on a site with 50 mouthy builders. If they saw a photo of me in a leotard, I'd never hear the end of it. Plus, there's your mum. Can you imagine her face if she thought the neighbours knew I spent the weekends jumping about in spandex? She'd never live it down. No, that's it, Jake. That's the promise we make here and now. No one except Mum and Lewis can know, or we give up before we begin. Deal?" Jake bit his lip. It wasn't perfect. Far from it. But they had to start somewhere. "Deal," said Jake, shaking on it, keeping the fingers of his other hand crossed behind his back. He wouldn't tell a soul. Oh, no. No way. At least, not yet. Chapter 3. Scalping the Slasher. It was Saturday, wrestling day, Jake's favourite day of the week, and he was spending the morning the same way he always did, loading up Dad's van with objects of demolition. Not sledgehammers or crowbars, they were for weekdays only. No, this was something entirely different. "One iron leotard? Check," said Jake happily. "Knee supports? Check. Wrestling boots? Check. Rubber wrecking ball on elastic chain? Checkity check." Jake didn't really need a list to remind him what to pack. He knew it off by heart. He just liked doing it. He also knew that he had to prepare the props without giving anyone the tiniest hint of Dad's alter ego. But Storey Street wasn't an easy place to keep things under wraps. And even this early on a Saturday morning, there were plenty of people about. Jake had lived on Storey Street all his life. He liked it too, mostly. the way everyone knew each other. Not in a nosy peeking through your curtains kind of way, more a stopping burglars nicking your laptop kind of way. It didn't matter if you lived in the posh red brick semis at the farm end of the road or the dilapidated old terraces in the shadow of Jake's school, like he did. Everyone knew each other. No one passed each other in the street without a morning, watcha, or how do. Half of the kids in Jake's class lived on the street, including his two best mates, Floss and Mouse, and that was the way he liked it. It did, however, make packing the van a tricky proposition. "What are you doing?" came a voice from behind him. Mouse. He and Floss were perched on their mountain bikes, backpacks full of food, heads full of adventure, hoping that Jake might join them for once. "Nothing," said Jake. He pretended to yawn and spread his arms wide to block his friend's view. "Just loading Dad's van." "Duh." "Obviously," chirped Floss. "But why?" "Helping him on a site, aren't I?" "On a Saturday?" "Buildings don't knock themselves down, you know," Jake said. "Fine," said Mouse with a sigh. "Your loss. We're going down the docks. Rumour is they found the hull of an old pirate Hang on! Is that a real wrecking ball in there?" He frowned. "It looks a bit rubbery." "Course it's real," snapped Jake, slamming the doors. "I can prove it if you like by wrapping it round your lug holes." That got a laugh. Jake, Floss and Mouse had known each other since their bikes had stabilisers. They knew everything about one another. Well, almost everything. Jake wanted to tell them about Dad. More than anything, he wanted to tell the whole world. But Dad trusted him, and he couldn't let him down. He watched as his two best friends cycled away. Then, feeling slightly wistful, he turned his attention back to the task in hand. After a few more minutes of intense concentration, a shadow fell over him. It was only when Jake spun around that he realised it wasn't a cloud blocking the sun. It was Masha Milner and his sidekicks, Saliva Shreve and Bunyan's Bootle. Attractive boys, both. If there was one downside to life on Storey Street, it was living near Masha. Lots of roads come complete with a masher. You know the type. A hulking, insensitive meathead with fists like cement and a desire to make people's life a misery. Especially people like Jake. It was like having his own 24-hour personal bullying service. Like all bully boys, Masher had an entourage. A bit like pop singers always carry little rat-like dogs in their handbags. "Hey, look, it's Dork Boy, son of Fat Man," said Masher. He was always going on about Dad's size. Jake tried to respond, but it was hard to talk with Masher's fingers up his nostrils. He concentrated instead on trying to imagine Dad body-slamming the bully from a great height. "What have you got in there?" Masha asked, wiping his fingers on Jake's shirt. "Just Dad's stuff for work," stuttered Jake. "What? Is packed lunch, is it?" he laughed. "You're never going to fit it all in there. You'd need a bus." "Yeah, a double-decker," Saliva guffawed. "So where are you off to today then, Biggs? A national pie-eating contest?" said Bunyans. "Or are you taking Daddy shoe shopping?" Masha was in his element now. "Must be years since that lad ball tied his own laces." "Or even so his feet," added Saliva. Sides were starting to split. "I heard that your dad is so fat, when he falls over and cuts himself, gravy comes out." That was it. All three of them almost lost control of their bladders, and Masha clambered into the van. "Get out!" Jake screamed. "There's private stuff in there!" Then something weird happened. The sun disappeared. Again. Masha turned with a frown as Tropical Storm Dad broke all over him. "What are you doing in my van, you tow rag?" Dad raged so ferociously that Masha and his guard dogs turned into a pack of scaredy cats. Gone were the taunts and insults. They whimpered something about looking for a lost ball before scampering away down the street. "What was that all about?" Dad asked. "Oh, nothing," Jake beamed proudly at Dad. "Ha! If Masha was scared now, imagine what he'd be like if he saw Dad in the ring. He wouldn't dare bully him then." When the van was loaded and the equipment ticked in triplicate, Dad and Jake were off over the hills to tonight's venue. A sports centre. Though sometimes it was a bingo hall or church. Wherever there was a ring and a cowering opponent, the demolition man would fight in it. And he never left defeated. "Who's tonight's mug? Opponent, Dad," said Jake. "Slasher the Barber Gash." "Oh yeah, of course. Good name." "Good persona too," said Dad. "Shaves the head of anyone he pins to the canvas." But Jake wasn't worried. He'd done his research. Knew Slasher's weaknesses. "He's not all that. Don't forget he works to a budget. Those clippers of his aren't even cordless. How can he beat you when the nearest plug socket is in the dressing room, 40 metres away?" "Well, maybe he's got an extension lead," Dad said, grinning. "Or some garden shears." "Need more than that to cut through this hair," Dad said. Jake believed him. He knew how today's fight was going to go. The crowd would boo, Dad would snarl, and the bell would ring. The demolition man would prowl forwards, full of menace, with one thing on his mind: inflicting pain. There was only going to be one winner. The demolition man would be going home with his ponytail intact. Chapter 4: Chicken Bones and Golden Beards. Jake should have been tired on the journey home, but he wasn't. He never was after watching Dad wrestle. Instead, he sat in the front of the van and relived every moment of the fight, while Dad speedily emptied a king-sized bag of cheesy balls. "It was amazing," Jake said. "The way you teased him with his clippers. He was so scared, he was on the verge of cutting his own hair off." Dad grinned, his bushy beard golden with the dust of 1,000 cheddary snacks. It made him look quite lion-esque, which suited him. After all, he was the king of the ring. "And what about the final move, eh, Jake? Just the way we planned it? Are you kidding me? It was perfect. Slasher didn't even touch the top rope as he flew over." Jake loved the way Dad finished off his opponents. More than he loved the outrageous costumes, boisterous ring walks and trash talking put together. Because Dad always dispatched his foes with his signature move, the wrecking ball. A whirling, swirling whoosh of the forearm that spun faster than a helicopter's propeller. And when that arm made contact flush on the chin, it was as if they'd been whacked by Dad's crane. That's how devastating it was. "I hope Slasher's all right," Dad said, stifling a yawn. It took the kiss of life from that old deer to bring him round. The yawn turned into a shudder. "Pass me the chicken legs, will you? I need something to take my mind off snogging grannies. It's killing my appetite." Jake rummaged in the hamper and found 6 fried chicken legs packed among a mountain of sausage rolls and chocolate bars, as well as a bag of rotting lettuce, which had been there so long that it was beginning to look more like seaweed. Smelt like it too. Dad shuddered at the sight of the green stuff before snatching it from Jake and throwing it out the window, triggering the angry horn of a car behind. "I don't know why your mum insists on buying that muck. She knows I'm allergic. Does funny things to my belly." "What? Like making it smaller?" choked Jake. "Exactly.
said Dad, sucking the meat from a chicken leg in one swift breath. And we can't have that, can we? Not when we're on a roll. The van went quiet. Jake thought about what Dad had just said. Something special was happening with his wrestling. He was on a roll, but not enough people were seeing his skills, and Jake couldn't help but want more than a crumbling sports centre and an audience with an average age of 89. Dad, Jake said, wouldn't you enjoy it more if the crowd was bigger and noisier? I mean, imagine a sea of people on their feet, screaming your name again and again. Dad didn't reply. He had a faraway look in his eyes. And for once, Jake didn't think he was fantasizing about food. He needed to keep the conversation going. Make Dad see his way of thinking. So, he continued, who do we fight next? I don't mind. Whoever they put in front of me. Jake thought hard. Problem is, I don't think there's anyone on our circuit who can pin you. 50 fights, and no one's even put you on the floor yet. All it takes is one blow, son, and all that can change. Any fighter can lose. What makes them a real champion is how they get up again. You hear me? Of course. It was a line Jake had heard many times before. Besides, there are plenty of good fighters out there. Ones we shouldn't write off. Like who? Giggles Maguire. You're kidding me, Jake said, laughing. No, he's dangerous. He's a clown. A kid's entertainer. So, who wears his mum's makeup? And? Jake sniggered. And his signature move is choking opponents with balloon animals. Like I said, he's dangerous. But, Dad, if he puts his giraffe anywhere near your beard, it'll burst. He's hardly a threat, is he? Dad thought again. The earthworm? Eddie McGraw? You'd squash him flat, no problem. The wrestling reverend? You'd make him eat his dog collar. Fat Boy Freddy, then. He's fearsome. Jake shook his head. Didn't you hear? He's had a gastric band fitted. Doctor's orders. Lost 15 stone and taken up flower arranging. Apparently, he has a real flair for it. The van fell silent, except for the sound of chicken legs being devoured. Dad was out of ideas, which left Jake to come to the following conclusion. There was no one who could beat his dad. He was untouchable. The greatest. The best of all time. But what was the point in Dad being the greatest if only he and a few grannies knew it? Jake slumped in his seat and watched as Dad effortlessly sucked the meat from another chicken leg. If the Demolition Man was going to get the recognition he deserved, it was up to Jake to do something about it. Chapter 5. The exits are here, here and here. Not everyone shared Jake and Dad's love of wrestling. Jake's mum, Lucy, hated everything about it, especially Dad's involvement. You're doing what? She'd gasp when Dad told her. What on earth are the neighbours going to say? They might be impressed, Dad said hopefully. Impressed? They'd be impressed if you finally fixed the front wall or cut the grass once in a while. I hardly think the sight of you in a leotard is something they're going to be dazzled by. Look, it's just a bit of fun. Something for me and Jake. No one else has to know. It'll be a secret between the four of us. Mum sighed dramatically before giving her reluctant seal of approval. They'd met long before Dad became a wrestler, before the beard, ponytail and belly. His, not hers. When Dad was still an athletic builder, laying bricks instead of ripping them down. Years ago, Mum had been an air hostess, and met Dad while serving him on her very first flight. Dad, feeling smitten, asked her for the most expensive gift on the trolley, and after coughing up his free peanuts in shock at the price, bought a £300 bottle of perfume, which he gave straight back to her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.